Welcome back. Now we will see how we can create forms in our React application. Basically, there are two type of components or two type of forms into our application. One is called the control forms or control components, and second is the uncontrolled components. Control components basically are the more preferred way to implement. React recommends using a control component to implement forms. In a control component, form data is handled by the React component in its states. So, in an uncontrolled component, the form data is handled by the DOM itself. So, if we use the control component, the data will be managed through states. And if we are using uncontrolled component, data can be saved into DOM as we do in our normal applications, and that can be accessed. So, what are the control components? In a control component, the form data is handled by the state within the component. The state within the component serves as a single source of truth for the input element that are rendering by the component. In HTML form, elements such as input, text area, and select maintain their own states and update it based on user input. With every key stored by the user, the state information will be updated automatically. In React, mutable state is typically kept in the state property of component and only updates with set state. So that is the way out. Whenever a user types something into the box, the value of the state will update automatically accordingly. This is an example. Here you can see what we are doing. We have declared a state variable value with zero, with empty braces, and we have also bind two of our function, handle changes and handle submit. In the handle changes, we are setting the state information accordingly. And with handle submit, we are basically displaying the state information. Here you can see what we are doing. Form on submit, we are calling handle submit, and on input. With value, what is the value? Value is the this dot state dot value. We are assigning this value to this basically variable. You can see there is no name into this property. We are not using the DOM to manipulate this. DOM uses names, refs for manipulation, but in React we can do it without any naming. We are just assigning the value to a state dot value, and whenever there is some change into the value, whenever user will type any information, it will call the function handle change. In the handle change, we are doing this dot set state, and whenever we set us and you can see here we are passing an event array, that is an event array, default array which contains the information about the event, and in it we are basically updating the value of this value variable with the event.target.value. So whenever user type something, it will automatically be updated into the state information. So this variable will be updated accordingly, and after updating the variable, when we click on the submit button, the submit handle submit function will be called, and in it what we are displaying, we are just displaying the state information which is always with us. So that is the way out with which we can handle the information within the form using the state variables. This is another example, just to let you know. This dot state, we have declared an input with null value, and then we have also put a variable form update and binded it with this function. And form update, what it is doing, it is updating the input variable with the event value. And you can see in the control form what we have done. We have assigned the value this dot state dot input, and on change this dot form update, the same as we have seen in the last example. And what we have this dot state dot input, we are also displaying as a very text. So this is the way out with which we can handle the information within our React component in forms. This was the example in simple one variable case. Now we have multiple variables, so we have to declare the states into it. Now I'm using specifically the two type of components, basically the checkbox, and the second is our simple variable. So for that, what we are doing, we will come back to this later. First we will see this, we have two states, is going true, by default it will be true, and number of guests, by default it will be 2. So we will go to our second part. In it, what we are doing, we are creating a label, is going, and input type is equal to checkbox. It is a checkbox, by default it will be true, it will be checked, and by default its value is this dot state dot is going, so by default it will be checked. On change, we are calling the function. The same on guest, we have assigned the value this dot state number of guest, by default it will be 2, and on change again we are calling handle input changes. Now we will go back and we will see in handle input changes what we are doing. We are actually took the target variable, and then we have applied the if condition. If the target dot name is going, because it is a checkbox, it doesn't have a property of value, but it is a property of check. If it is going, we will use the property target dot checked. If other than this, every property will contain a target dot value. So that we are setting target dot value or target dot checked as value, and then we are updating the information accordingly. This is the way out with which we are assigning the variable. Here you can see the same system as you have seen in Angular, the one-way data binding. The value has been assigned to the property. So this is the way out with which you can handle multiple inputs. And before going on to uncontrolled form, let's take a more precise example of the code. This is a sample form. This is contact form. Just to show you how it works, this if it has a multiple information into it, first name, last name, telephone number, email, agree, contact us, message, etc. We have defined all the initial states, and we have defined the touch property. Touch property means have the user updated it or not. It is by default the false. It by default no one has touched the property, and whenever that specific property box will be touched, it will update accordingly. And then we have input change, the same concept as we have seen in the slides. You can see the same sort of code here. Handle submit, we are just displaying that information from the state variable, so nothing specific and special into it. And you can see how to validate the form. There is a complete form validation. You can apply different if else conditions into that form validation. You can apply the rejects into it, etc. You can apply all type of validation into it. And on submit, what we are doing, we are basically validating the form, and this is the complete form. In that complete form, what we are doing, we are basically this we are calling the handle submit, and what we are doing, we are basically assigning the value this dot state dot first name, and valid, invalid states, and on blur, on change, we are calling different events, and you will see the same sort of things on every node, every component, every input type. You will see the value, valid, invalid, just the name is updated, and we have applied multiple things. We have applied the methods, we have applied the values, and this way you can complete the form. Although this handling of this form is a bit confusing or lengthy, not a confusing but a lengthy, but the handling is much better using our controlled form. But we can use also uncontrolled form. Uncontrolled component acts more like traditional HTML form elements. The data for each input element is stored in a simple DOM object, not into a component React state. So instead of writing an event handler for all your state updates, you use the word ref. Basically, instead of name property, you will use the ref property. Ref will provide you the value within the component anywhere. So React provides you the ref array into your application. Refs provides a way to access DOM nodes or React elements created in the render method. So refs are created using react.createRefs. Refs are attached to input elements using the ref attribute on the element in question. Refs are often used as instance property on a component. The ref is set in the constructor and the value is available throughout the component. You cannot use the ref attribute on functional components because an instance is not called, but still there is a way you can use refs. I will show you the both type of examples. This is an example of refs. In the constructor, we are creating basically a ref, this dot input type of ref, and we are assigning the input property. We are not assigning the name here, we are providing the ref here. And by providing the ref, this input is available, this dot input is available into the function. Now you can see here we are just accessing this this dot input dot current dot value. Dot current is actually the ref value, ref current state, and dot value is the value. So this dot input dot current is actually the current reference, the current input value of input of that that specific input type, and dot value will provide you the value whatever it has been written into it. So you can reuse the refs to access the information. This is another example. You can see this dot file input. If the type is upload file, and you can access that file into your component dot current dot files dot zero, because file zero is file is always in the shape of array. So files zero means the file that has been attached to it, and you can access the name and etc. Whatever you want to perform the activity, you can access that file input. So this is the way out with you can use the ref, and you can use it in functional components. In it, what we have to do, you have to declare the ref, you have to create the react.createRefs, and there is no constructor, it is simple functional component, and set focus, you have text input.current.focus, and you can focus on that specific element. Before going on to display this, I am showing you another example. This GitHub code is also available. I have implemented it in very simplest way. You can see I have used the property ref instead of name. Name is equal to name. I have used the ref name, ref designation. So now you can receive this ref. Sorry, you can receive this ref into a function. For example, add employee is a function which has an event. You can write the E is the abbreviation of event, or you can write the full event. And you are basically here you are restricting the default behavior, you are preventing default, you are writing your own code, so you have to prevent default. So event dot prevent default, and now you will write your own. Now I am accessing this name and designation from the refs. So this is another way out to use the refs. Now I have not initialized that react.createRef or etc. You can see here that there is nothing like this into it. I have created the refs in my application. Down here I have used these refs directly, and then access this as the this.refs.name, this.refs.designation, and using these two variables to send it to the REST API, and we will see in the next example, next lecture. So this is another way to use the uncontrolled form. Now going back, controlled form and uncontrolled form. Basically, we will recommend that you should use the controlled form more often. Uncontrolled forms are easy to implement, but not easy to handle. While controlled forms are easy to handle, but definitely it needs more code to implement the things. So use controlled components whenever possible. Controlled components do not require a form elements in order to be considered a controlled component. If a component has an input element that has a value attribute bound to state and an event handler to update said value, it is called a control component. For pages that have a large number of input elements, it can be cumbersome to work with controlled components. Data flow is unidirectional, that means the data from form to states is control component, with the state within the component acting as a single source of truth. All state changes within a controlled component should be made via the set state function. In uncontrolled function, components store their data in the DOM like the traditional HTML function. React.createRefs is the layout with which you can access the refs attributes, and you can apply those on the input variables and can access those variables. Ref cannot be used on functional component, and but I have shown you, but there is a layout you can use it. So these are controlled and controlled component. Next, we are there is some new concept, and that is called the using hooks. The using hook is another layout with which you can use the functional components to access the states. Hooks are functional functions that look let you hook into React state and lifecycle features from functional components. You are not creating the class component, but you are using the feature of class component. Hooks does not work inside the classes. They let you use React without classes. So this is not for the class component. React provides a few built-in hooks like use state. You can also create your own hooks to reuse stateful behavior between different components. It renders a counter. For example, this function renders a counter. When you clicked on the button, it increments the value. For example, here you can see we have imported the React and use state from the React. And we have created a functional component. In it, we have declared a constant set count and count, which will be using the use state. Here, what we are doing, you click count times. By default, it is 0. Button on click. Whenever the button will be clicked, set count, count plus 1. It will add a new value to the count, and that will be save. And that is the layout with which it basically save the new state of the variable without using class component. So using the functional components, we are basically saving the value of the states. And with this functional hooks, we can also use this for our forms. Here you can see use states. And same site of same style, constant username and set username, use state empty by default. Input name is equal to username, value is equal to username. You can see we are setting this a value, username as a value. And then on change, what we are doing, we are writing the component, the function here. We are passing the event, and passing the event, what we are doing, set dot username. We are calling this function. We are updating the state of this username to e.target.value. Whatever the new value will be, it will be assigned to this username, and that will be automatically available with the value. So this is a very new concept. React has started it after 16 point something. So you can use hooks also. This is a third way out. We have seen a controlled form. We have seen uncontrolled form. We have seen hooked forms. So this is the third way out. For multiple field, you can do it the same. You can define the values, you can call the set basically set functions for these, and you can set the states accordingly. This is much better than it looks much better than your control forms. So it works same as your control forms are, but it is a new way out in React. Then the fourth way out is using React Redux forms. We will see in our Redux lecture that how we can use React Redux forms to create basically the forms into our application. You can create forms using React Redux state management principle. So you don't need to save the states within your component. Those states will be handled by the React Redux. First we will cover the Redux part, then we will see how this React Redux form will work. So wait for one lecture, we will come back to this also. This is the fourth way out, and then we have the fifth way out also, and that is Form IK. That is recommended by React, PharmIQ is a small library that helps you to do three basic things. One is to getting the value in and from the form states, validating doing validations on the form, and third, handling form submission. So three works can be done using this PharmIQ. In it, what you have to do, you have to install the npm install PharmIQ or yarns add PharmIQ, or you can use the CDN directly. And after using this, you can use this PharmIQ into your application. I'm getting the form different things from the PharmIQ, and we are creating the PharmIQ. And what we are doing the initial setting the initial value, we are doing the validated functions, and we are after validating function, we basically apply the form principles onto it, and we are also writing the onSubmit function. This is the layout with which you can apply the PharmIQ. There are numerous examples that has been provided by PharmIQ. Just go to their site and you will see a numerous built-in written code for your forms. You can select any from that and you can apply accordingly. This is a easy and simplest way to apply the PharmIQ. That's all from the current lecture. Today we have seen the, basically different sort of forms. We have seen the control form, we have seen the uncontrolled form, we have seen basically the hook based form, we have seen we have just listened about or just know about the React Redux form, but we will see in next lecture, one lecture ahead, and then we have seen the PharmIQ. So these are different sort of forms that are available to implement in our React application. Thank you. We will meet in our next lectures.